As you make the journey towards heaven, towards that mansion that Jesus promised us, that he has gone to prepare for us, you need to be reminded that you could be refused entrance. If you are in the habit of refusing to help those who are in need of your care and compassion. You say to me, "Preacher, that's hokey theology. Where do you get it from?" I point you to Matthew, the 25th chapter, verse 41 to verse 46. Is it not ignorance, or proclaiming their ignorance of the opportunities that they had to do good, which resulted in the exclusion of people from heaven? You remember Jesus said to them, "You didn't take care of prisoners, you didn't clothe the naked, you didn't feed the hungry." And they said, "Lord, we hate to tell you this, but you're mistaken." He said, "You didn't." He said, "Lord, when did we see you in need and not help? We would never have done that." And the Lord said to them, "Inasmuch as you failed to seize the opportunities to show it to these, the least of my brethren, you failed to show it to me. Therefore, you have no place in heaven." Let us put it this way, brethren. If it is the case that Matthew 7, 21 is addressed to the denominations, you know what I'm talking about, a favorite passage among churches of Christ. "You had no authority," the Lord tells the denominationalists, "to do the things you did." Then surely it must be that Matthew 25 is addressed to we who are members of the Church of Christ, addressed to us who are members of the Church of Christ, where we had authority and opportunity and failed to seize it. And yet, the excuse is ignorance. For the last several days, we have been examining our multifaceted responsibilities as Christians. And there are many responsibilities that a Christian has. Tonight, we are supposed to be looking at our responsibility to be caring and compassionate. The proposition, though, is riddled with, it's filled with assumptions, which I suppose we need to prove before we can persuade you to do what you ought to do. Facing the responsibility of being more caring and compassionate. I want to turn the words around a little bit. I want us to begin by discussing whether indeed there is any such responsibility for the Christian. Does the Christian have a responsibility to be caring and compassionate? I feel like this section of my lesson, though, is redundant because Dave did a more than able job yesterday at the 11 o'clock session in outlining to us, in taking us from Old Covenant to New Covenant scriptures, outlining for us all the stipulations that God has made regarding our conduct to our fellow man. Over and over, Dave asks us the question, what kind of God is this that would legislate about your attitude towards a donkey who has fallen into a pit? What kind of God would tell you that if you're reaping your produce, once you go over the field, don't go over a second time? Leave what is left for the poor. God is a busy person. He doesn't have time to get involved in such details. Why doesn't he just leave us alone to figure it out for ourselves? But perhaps a more fundamental question to ask is, why did God give all these laws to the Semitic people? Was it not to distinguish them by their conduct from the nations around them? You see, man treating man fairly and rightly and justly and equitably is not natural. We tend to want to shaft each other. and ignore each other and give only as much as we need to give, as little as we can give. Not so. God is generous. And so he said to the Jews, if you want to be known as my people, if you want to have a relationship with me and live in heaven with me, you must take on my character. And I am kind and compassionate. And so you need to be. So there is such a responsibility for the Christian. This responsibility, firstly, as we've intimated, is rooted in the character of God. And we're called upon to grow and to change and to become more and more like God. Indeed, Jesus came to earth as the revelation of God, to make God known. And Jesus was known for his compassion. It oozed out of Jesus. That was his habit. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But, you know, think a little bit more about God. Scriptures tell us the most well-known verse of the Bible in all the world. God so loved that he gave his one and only Son. Why? So Jesus could redeem us, so Jesus could do for us what we could not do for ourselves. Glory be to Jesus, who in bitter pains poured for me his lifeblood from his sacred veins. That was compassion, was it not? But not only is it our responsibility to be compassionate and caring because it is rooted in the character of God, it is our responsibility because it has actually been commanded. Turn with me to 1 Timothy chapter 6, a passage to which Dave referred yesterday. Verse 17, command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God who gives us richly all things to enjoy. Let them do good that they may be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share. You say, obviously that doesn't apply to me because I ain't rich. Well, that's a relative term. And compared to the rest of the world, we are rich. So, end of story. We've refuted your argument. You are rich. So you're hereby commanded by God to be ready to expend yourself. The command comes to us also, though, in, you know, we might say almost every book of the Bible. You remember James in his argument in the second chapter in trying to show that faith must be backed by actions. The example he gives, he says, if a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, James 2:15, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are in need for the body, what does it profit? He's saying, you're just talking. And that's worthless. Talk is cheap. I think John really comes down on it, though. You know, John is called the apostle of love, and both in his gospel account and in his epistles, he certainly spends a lot of time talking about love and defining it for us. And you remember in chapter 3, verse 16, by this we know love because he laid down his life for us. And we also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. You mean I have to die for my brethren? Physically, well, maybe that's a remote possibility. But you know, he goes on to tell us what he means. You got to love the scriptures for their practicality. But whoever has this world's goods, you see, rubber meets the road. We're talking now about stuff, things, possessions, and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart from him. How does the love of God abide in him? My little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. So we have this responsibility rooted in the character of God, commanded, and we have already established, based on our text in Matthew 25, that it is an essential criterion for entry into heaven. Let me put it this way. You cannot step over others and enter heaven. What's the story of rich man and Lazarus and the rich man about? The rich man's crime was that he passed Lazarus every day and didn't even think to help him. He didn't extend any hand to Lazarus. He didn't do a thing. He didn't notice, or really. Is that it? But we need to move on. So we've outlined that it is our responsibility. And Maxie has really written the topic very well, because he says it is our responsibility, but we need to turn and face it. Brethren, somehow we want to shirk this responsibility. But that is historically the case with men, is it not? What is the story of Jonah about in part? Jonah, wanting to shirk his responsibility to preach to the Ninevites because of his prejudice. He didn't want to do it. And in the end he said, you know, God, I knew you were like that. Caring, compassionate, soft. You know, that's essentially what he said to God. He didn't want to do it. He didn't want to face up to his responsibilities. You remember the disciples of Jesus in Mark 6 and in Mark 8? Jesus, having preached to the multitudes, he turned to the disciples and said to them, look, I have compassion on these people. They have been with me several days. If I send them away without something to eat, they're going to faint. You know what the disciples said? Lord, tough. We don't got no bread. It's going to take too much bread. And besides, we don't got no money. So you know what? It's getting late. Send them off. Let them go fend for themselves. And Jesus he didn't even bother take the time to rebuke them. He just ignored them and said, how many loaves do you have? The disciples wanted to shirk that responsibility. And so it is. You know, with the dismantling of the welfare state, and perhaps rightly so, it seems instead of becoming more compassionate to the poor and the disenfranchised, we are becoming more calloused. And, you know, as Dave said yesterday, we are quick to refer to the text which says, you know, man done work he shouldn't eat. God is kind to the unjust and to the ungrateful. He causes it to rain on the just and the unjust. He saved us when we were in our sins. We need to face up to this responsibility. The story of Ruth, beautiful story. Is it not in part about facing up to the responsibility to be caring and compassionate? You know the story. We do not have the time to rehash it. But let's briefly look at it. Here was Ruth, married into a Jewish family. Her father-in-law died. Her husband died. And now her mother-in-law says, look, there's nothing going for me down in this country, Moab. I want to return to Bethlehem. I call her a little bit cranky, and it's true. She was kind of having a nervous breakdown. Naomi was, you know? You remember when she got back to Bethlehem and they said, hey, Naomi, she said, you don't call me by that name. That means pleasant. Call me Mara, bitter. The Lord has dealt terribly with me. And you remember she had two daughters-in-law, Orpah and Ruth. And initially, when she said she was going back, they said, oh, we're going to go with you, Mom. We're going to go with you. And she said, why? Ain't nothing here. Why? Stay with your people. You know, what you going to do? She says, I don't have no husband. And even if I had one and I had kids, you're going to wait on them till they grow up? Girls, it's not practical. Essentially, that's what she said to them. It isn't practical for you to return with me. And Orpah said, you know what, Mom? You're right. See you around. And you remember Ruth? She says, do not persuade me to leave you or to turn from following after you. Where you live, I will live. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Where you die, there will I die and be buried. May the Lord do so to me and more, if anything but death should separate you and me. Interestingly, we use those at weddings, and yet it was a daughter-in-law, ex-daughter-in-law, if you would, professing her loyalty and her commitment and her compassion on to her mother-in-law. Well, what's going on in this story? Ruth understood the fourth commandment, honor your father and mother. Doesn't mean just yes, mommy, yes, daddy. It means taking care of them when they are in need of your help. And she did just that. But wait a while, it's not just as simple as that. She was a foreigner. The Gentiles were hated, the Moabites were hated by the Jews because the Jews had dealt treacherously with them in the past. She was a woman in a man's world, and yeah, even more. That at that time in Israel's history, they were wicked. In those days, there was no king in Israel. Every man did what was right in his own eyes. What's she going back to Bethlehem to do? She ain't got no job. She ain't got no contacts. What's she going there to do? How's she going to support herself, let alone her mother-in-law? But she knew Naomi was aged and weak. And if she can't make it, how little a chance does Naomi have to make it? So she went. And do you remember there she met a man, Boaz, who understood the need to show compassion, as was stipulated in the law to the foreigner, to the disenfranchised. And you remember, we don't have time for the details, how he said to his servants, look, you know what you guys do? Leave a little bit extra. Not only should you not touch her and let her eat with us, but leave a little extra for her. He understood compassion. But what about Orpah? The tragedy of missed opportunities. You know, I think Naomi selected her words wisely. You remember what she said? Return to your people and your gods. Prior to their encounter with this Jewish family, those girls were polytheistic, worshipped many gods. They had come to learn the gospel, we might say. I think we can use that. And come to take refuge under Jehovah. And suddenly, that religion was now worthless to Orpah because it costs. You see, brethren, we want to shirk this responsibility because it costs to show compassion. It costs. We have to move on. Being more caring and compassionate, Maxie says he wants us to discuss. As he said earlier, he supposes that we are caring and compassionate, but he thinks we need to do so more and more. And of course, that's what scriptures say, you know, we should grow in the Christian graces, 2 Peter 1. We should not get to a stage where we want to care less, but should want to care more. I believe the story, which again Dave used yesterday, the Samaritan, shows us what it means to be more caring and compassionate. You'll recall the Levite and the priest missed the opportunity, too busy. I used to think in that story they were on their way to temple, but they were coming from Jerusalem, going down. So they just got off work. Had to get home to the wife and kids. Hadn't seen them for days, you know? So, you know, you're on a mission. You can't stand that interruption. Besides, could be dangerous, you know? Sorry. I don't have my cell phone, but as I get home, I'll call somebody. Yeah, well, the hero of the story is the Samaritan, and I believe the Samaritan really is Jesus. What do we notice about him? He looked. If we are to be more caring and compassionate, brethren, we need to open our eyes. Back to Matthew 25. Is it not the case that those who said, Lord, don't shut the door on us, they said, Lord, if we knew, we would have done it. We would, Lord, you know us, we would never have missed the opportunity to do good. But brethren, we fail to look. Matthew 9, wonderful verse. The Bible says, as Jesus went, Matthew 9, 35 and 36, as he went out and he preached, he saw the multitudes and they were harassed, right? And helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And he had compassion on them. Brethren, we have to look for the need. It will not always knock on our doors. There are plenty of opportunities. But if we are so heavenly focused that we're no earthly good, we will miss the opportunities. God will not take our excuse. The next thing about the Samaritan is he had courage. As you know, he could have been mugged and whatnot. But he got down and dirty. He got blood on him. He took the time to endanger himself, if you would. See, it takes courage. It takes guts to care. And I use those words deliberately. For compassion, look up the word and study it, comes from deep within the guts. This, our society has gotten so emotional. You look at all those slayings, you know, the shootings, like in the church here in Fort Worth, in Colorado, and like 15 services, and we cry and we weep. Please do not equate tears with compassion. In fact, the impulse of the moment is often fleeting. That is not compassion. You see, compassion requires that we take a reasoned approach instructed by the Word of God and sustained by the will. Look at this Samaritan. What did he do? You know the story in Luke 10? He rearranged his whole day's schedule to accommodate this bleeding man. Don't you think he was going somewhere? He was a businessman. He said to the innkeeper, hey, when next I'm passing by, I'll take care of the rest of the bill. He didn't think it was inconvenient. He personally bandaged up the man's wound, put oil on it, and then brought him into safekeeping where he could be nursed to health. Many times we do not show the care and the compassion which we need to the lost, and we'll talk about that in a second. Because we are too busy, and we're busy with important things. But brethren, we must be prepared to brook interruptions. There is the rub. We do not want to be interrupted. We have our little lives worked out so neatly. Got to get the kids to that. Got to go to aerobics. They got to go to church. You know. Is anybody listening? He rearranged his schedule. He was flexible. Put it that way. He immersed himself in the man's problems. You know, some of us would like to think he went overboard to offer to pay the bill next time he came by, having put up money. Come on. But you know, every time the scripture instructs us to be caring and to be compassionate, what is it rooted in? It is premised on the love of God. Since God so loved us, we ought to love each other. Have you examined the depths of God's love? We hinted at it earlier when we referred to John 3:16. He gave his one and only, the best he had. That makes us obligated to follow God's lead. But no, we need to get more practical. We have been talking up there. Let's come down here. Brethren, I fear that we are fearful of each other. We just, you know, the Bible warns against being a busybody and being meddlesome. And there's a sense to which we need to keep our distance. I think Scripture says that, even in Galatians 6, a passage to which we'll refer in a second, more detail, it says, you need to bear your own load, Joe. But then a few seconds later, it says, I need to help you to bear your own load. So we have to strive for that balance. But I fear there is a mentality that we'll do as little as we can, and we will give, you know, in a not so personal way. We don't want to get involved. I want to talk about a neglected command, which is written in 1 Peter 4, 9 to 11. The command there being to show hospitality. Do you know it is a qualification of an elder that he be hospitable? Talk about God getting into details. The Bible says there in 1 Peter 4, we need to offer hospitality to each other without grumbling. Why would it link the two? Ever stop to think about it? Because we make a lot of excuses and we whine about why we can't do this. And, well, you know, I would, but, you know, if I invite, she has all those kids, they could destroy, you know, whatever. Brethren, you know what we're talking about here? I believe in part we're talking about the glue that will hold us together and get us to heaven. Which one of us doesn't get depressed and down because of the difficulties of life? Which one of us has ever resented getting a card in the mail from an unexpected source reaffirming us and encouraging us? I just hated that card. It was too encouraging. I didn't like the way she took my hand and said, are you okay? Is there anything you need? I'm here for you. We've spent a lot of time, as I think Dan prayed, about the wicked old world in which we live. Well, I believe being more caring and compassionate is one of the ways in which we are to insulate ourselves from the world and all that it throws at us. You say, well, I don't like that because we are to reach out to the world. I agree. But you remember Galatians 6, 8 to 10? Interesting. You know, we've had many lessons on the need to study God's word, each word of it, because it's so incredible the way the word is written. Listen to it. For he who's, verse 9, and let us not grow weary while doing good. Look at those words. Let us not grow weary while doing good. What happens to you after you help somebody for a little while? It's too much, you know. My resources, they're dwindling. Emotionally, this is too draining. Man, this I can't take it anymore. God knows us. He knows our psyche. And so he says to us, do not become weary. Persevere. Have some stick-to-itiveness. And I still have made the point I'm driving at yet. It says here, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. That verse tells me charity begins at home. Hello. Charity begins at home. Yes, we need to show compassion to the world and preach the gospel to them. But I'm telling you, we will do a better job if we join hands and strengthen each other. And you remember what it says there in Hebrews 3? It says, let us instill courage in each other daily as long as it is still called today. There are courage robbers. Come to you, say, stick it up. You went to your doctor, you hear you have health problems. Or your kid got in trouble, you realize your kid's on drugs. Big fight with your spouse, knocked down, drag out, got laid off from the job. You lost your husband, you're now a widow, or you're a widower. Those things rob us of our courage and they get us inwardly focused. The Bible says we are to look around and notice and have compassion. But not at a superficial level. You okay? Do you need some food? I'll make some. You ever seen those prison movies when they get sent to solitary and then the guard pulls the thing back and chucks the food in there and shuts the door? That's how we tend to show compassion. You'll starve if you don't get any food, so here's your food. No, we're supposed to open the door of the cell and get in there. Because solitary, the punishment is that you're alone, no one to talk to, no one to bring light into your life. We're going to spend eternity in heaven together, so we may as well get used to being together here. We may as well be, and we need to, you know, Maxie jokingly says, I know him like a book and he knows me very well. But it is true. We've so studied each other that he can look in my eyes and see, Everett, are you okay? And I can look in his eyes and see, Maxie, you're not okay. I don't even ask. What's going on, brother? And we can talk. In spite of our differences, we can talk. And we've shared things. I've gone in there and shut the door. And Maxie, and of course, brother. Or he says, come on in here. And we talk. That's how we are to know each other and confide secrets. Now, I'm not saying you got to have this relationship with the rest of the 400 members in the congregation or the 200, but we're to build those kinds of relationships with each other. Then that will give us the courage and a platform on which we can reach out to the rest of the world. We are to share the scarce commodities of money, time, emotion, affection, which we would prefer to keep for ourselves and our loved ones. We're to share it with each other. That's the command. That's what we're examining. We've been told all that we need to get out there and do. But believe it or not, one phone call can change your day, change the course of your life. But with each other, supporting each other, we can get the job done. We have to get the job done. But no matter how much we talk here, as a practical matter, when we leave, we have to go and face life, bills, difficulties. You know what yours are. And it's lightened and it's easier when we're in there with one another. You know, scriptures are not down on us spending time on ourselves and money. In fact, every command we get to show to others, well, not every, but many of them, suggests that you just need to do it to others like you do it to yourself. Philippians 3 or 2, look not to your own things, but to the things of others. Love your neighbor as yourself. Ain't nothing wrong in pampering yourself. Perhaps it's best summed up in, do to others what you want done to you. That's what we're talking about, brethren. You remember Jesus? Why did he shed tears at the funeral of, or when he went to Lazarus, to the sisters, Mary and Martha? You remember what the people said? Behold how he loved him. He identified with the grief of those sisters. You remember that leprous man in Matthew 8? Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. The Bible says, Jesus said, I'm willing, and he touched him. Why did he touch him? Think through those. Compassion comes from deep within the soul. But here's the final thing I want to say. Perhaps the reason why we're not more compassionate and caring and why we don't attend to each other's needs more is that we have such pressing needs ourselves that we are wanting others to reach out to us. I remember when I first came to Brown Trail as a student. I remember Wednesday nights, how I hated coming here. I would sit on the bench and Nobody would come over and say hello.
And I said to Gary Fowler, Gary,
can you give me special permission to, I'm going to go to a smaller congregation. These people are cold. Whatever. The Bible says he who would be friendly must, he who would have friends must himself be friendly. We're all so insecure about something about our lives, and it makes us so self-centered. Well, listen to this. Everybody is insecure too. So you know what will give you more security? Reaching out. And then others will reach back to you, taking the time to expend yourself on others' behalf. You say, but Everett, this lesson is not practical enough. You haven't given me enough specifics. Well, you want specifics? Remember the story of Ruth and the story of the Good Samaritan. I don't know what circumstances you're going to meet tomorrow that requires your attention. I don't know who is going to need you to help them tomorrow and in what way they'll need you to help them. But stick with them. Go with them the whole way. And don't pull out halfway. There is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. That friend is Jesus. You remember what Jesus said in Matthew. Speaking of himself, I believe these are perhaps the only truly complimentary words Jesus ever said of himself. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. He said, come to me, stick with me. You remember he said of God, a bruised reed he will not break, a smoldering wick he will not put out. And here it is, he is saying the same thing of himself in another way. Brethren, we can't be so stingy and so insecure that we are just focused on ourselves. Others need us. And trust me, you know it. Trust the Lord. When you reach out your hands to others, they will take it and they will give back to you. You know it when it comes to the lost. This lesson obviously pertains to having the compassion on the lost. We cited Matthew 9. After that, Jesus sent out the disciple. After he had compassion on the multitudes, he said, come, go preach to them. But I felt tonight we needed to talk more about being there for each other and being there for each other emotionally, reaffirming each other. We got so much that we're afraid of, and we can be so plastic and tiptoe around each other. And I'm not saying it's the case in every and any situation. Let's end our lesson here by reading from Hebrews 13. Let brotherly love continue. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing some have unwittingly entertained angels. Remember the prisoners as if chained with them, those who are mistreated, since yourselves are in body also. And look at verse 16. Do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifices God is pleased. This business of being caring and compassionate is rooted in God's nature. We're not going to be happy, separate and apart from God excluding us from heaven because of our refusal. We wouldn't even be happy there, because we're going to think we don't have anything in common with God, you know, because he's too mushy. We got to learn, folks. And it begins here. The Bible says you can't love God whom you've never seen and hate your brothers. And then read the text. It says hating is not meeting their needs, whatever they are. It said, don't be a murderer like Cain. Well, I don't mean stab him or cut off his head. It means ignoring and not meeting his emotional, spiritual, and physical needs. That is the glue. According to this thing, I got 23 seconds. You know, if you're not a Christian tonight, you're missing out. Even though we speak like this, This is much better than anything that is in the world. A day in the Lord's court is better than 1,000 years in the world. And we need you. We have a mission to seek and save the lost. And we need you to sign up and be willing to join us. God gave his son for you. I don't know what else he can do. There's nothing else that he can, that he will, that he needs to do. You need to respond. And we encourage you to respond tonight. Come forward. We will baptize you in just a moment if you understand the commitment that is required and you're willing to accept Jesus as Lord. And if you are a member who's been out of duty and somehow you've been here through the providence of God, then come back tonight to the family. We want you. We need you. Above all, though, brethren, let's get up, go out there, and face this responsibility. Let's not shirk it. If you have a need, please come as together we stand and we sing.
Brother Everett Chambers did a masterful job in bringing a lesson to stir our hearts, in being more compassionate and caring toward our fellow man, and especially toward our brethren. And I pray that each one of us will implement those principles of conduct in our lives. I want to read with your consideration 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. I'm reading from the American Standard Translation. The apostle wrote and said, "Finally, be ye all like-minded, compassionate, loving as brethren, tender-hearted, humble-minded, not rendering evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but contrariwise a blessing, for hereunto were you called, that you should inherit a blessing." That's Christianity. And we really need to live the Christian life. And I hope and pray that the impressions of this hour will linger in our hearts for a long, long time. We've heard two masterful discourses from Brother Paul Sain, Brother Everett Chambers, and we thank both of these brethren. We're going to close with a word of prayer, and after we have worded this prayer, we're going to sing this beautiful hymn, "Nearer My God to Thee." And I pray that that thought will continue to linger in our hearts for a long, long time, throughout our whole lives, as we live our lives from day to day. May our prayer be, "Nearer, my God, to thee." Will you bow your heads with me while we pray? Almighty God in heaven above, unto thee we ascribe all the glory and the praise and the honor, both now and forever and forever. We realize that thou art worthy, and we prostrate ourselves before thee in humility, in full recognition of thy glory, and with the desire of our hearts from deep within to sing praises to thee, to express unto thee our love and our profound appreciation for all that thou hast done for us, and for all that thou dost continue to do for us as we live our lives on this earth. How thankful we are for that great expression of thine infinite love in the personage of Jesus Christ, and for his willingness to sacrifice his precious blood to make it possible for us to be right with thee and have the hope of life eternal. Dear Father, we're so thankful for the impressions that we've gained over these last 4 days from these beloved brothers in Christ who've brought to us stimulating and stirring thoughts from thy word, which will make us better people if we will but receive them into our lives and make them a part of our everyday living. And we pray that indeed we will. We pray, Father, that this congregation and congregations of thy people throughout the brotherhood will come to be the kind of people that thou would have us to be, loving and caring and kind and considerate and tender-hearted, reaching out to those who are less fortunate than ourselves, sharing the gospel truth with as many people as we possibly can, bringing the lost ones unto thee, and encouraging the faint-hearted and lifting up the downtrodden. Bless us, our Father, as we live our lives before thee in this brief earthly sojourn. And may it be our prayer day by day to live nearer to thee, nearer, our God, to thee. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Will you be standing as we sing?
Nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee, e'en though it be a cross that raiseth me. Still all my song shall be, gone down, darkness be over me, my rest a stone. Yet in my dreams I'd be nearer, my God, to thee, nearer, my God, to thee, nearer to thee. There let the way appear, steps unto heaven. All that thou sendest me in mercy gives, angels to beckon me on joyful wing, cleaving the sky, sun, moon, and stars forgot, upward I fly. Still all my song shall be, shall be nearer, to thee.